of caramel. Food will in the midst of caramel. Food will in the midst of caramel. Feed our people with the rod of flock of the heritage. Food will solitude in the wood. In the midst of caramel. Food will 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 in the midst of caramel.
Leviticus 26:39. And they that are left of you shall pine away in their iniquity in your enemies' lands. And also in the iniquities of their fathers shall they pine away with them. Pining away, wasting away, deteriorating. Why should we pine away, withering off? Why should we wither off? We had a reading of that chapter from verse 1 to 13. We are able to read a list of blessings the Lord has got in store for you. Then what's the question of this pining away, withering off, wasting away, deteriorating? My dear brother, my dear sister, Leviticus 26 is a very powerful chapter, a chapter with a lot of prophetic importance. And later, the parallel of this chapter is Deuteronomy chapter 28. Many times people consider on Deuteronomy chapter 28. And Deuteronomy chapter 28 is only a latter parallel of Leviticus chapter 26. When Moses comes to the end of the book of Leviticus, the Lord tells Moses the secret of blessings and curses. We had a series of messages on blessings and curses. This morning we are just going to have a commentary, an exposition on this chapter, Leviticus chapter 26. We shall go from verse 1 and we'll have a reading.
Ye shall make you no idols, nor graven image, neither rear up a standing image, neither shall ye set up any image of stone in your land to bow down unto it, for I am the Lord your God.
So the Lord starts with the first commandment. You shall make no idols, no graven image. no standing image, neither shall ye set up any image of stone in your land, in your heart, in your house, the purpose of it to bow down unto it, to seek its favor. Don't have any image to seek its favor, for I am the Lord your God. Number 2.
Ye shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord.
You keep my Sabbath, reverence my sanctuary. Again he says, for I am the Lord. I am the Lord your God. Verse 3.
If ye walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then I'll give you rain.
Keep my statutes. Keep my commandments. Do them. In this morning meditation, number 1, 4 fundamental principles of God's blessings. Then I will bless you with all these blessings. It's the 4 fundamental principles of God's blessings. I call this formula for blessings. It's God's formula for our blessings. 4 things the Lord says. Number 1, idolatry forbidden in our lives. Number 2, Sabbath should be sanctified. Number 3, have reverence to worship place. And number 4, obedience to His word. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's nothing to do with the religion. It's not the teaching of Christianity, it's not the teaching of Islam, it's not the teaching of Judaism, it's not the teaching of any other religion. God is against idolatry. God is against idolatry. It's not a Hindu God or a Christian God or a Muslim God. God is against idolatry in any form. You will be surprised to note, in Bhagavad Gita 7:19-21 say, and those who do idol worship, all those who worship demigods are materialistic people. They are not spiritualistic people. All those who worship idols and any other god, they are materialistic people. It is in Bhagavad Gita. As Hindus got idols, many idols, so Christians also. They keep a cross, they keep the picture of Mary or Jesus, and different types of pictures. Somebody said there are more than 300 types of very popular pictures of Jesus. Now another Jesus, Son of God picture is also coming. I don't know how many houses are going to adorn with that picture. My dear brother, my dear sister, all scriptures say one and the same thing. Don't worship idols. In Yajur Veda 3:32, Yajur Veda says, of that one God, you cannot make any images. That is why for the prime God Brahma, even today I think in Hindus, they don't have an image. Of that one God, make no image. I saw one slogan, Natasya Pratima Asti. Natasya Pratima Asti. It is in Yajur Veda, chapter 32, verse 3. There is no image of God. And another place that Veda says, all those who worship the uncreated things, they are in darkness. You worship something which is not at all created, you are in darkness. And you'll enter more into darkness if you worship the created things. That is why Sivavagya Siddhar said, Nattakallai Devam endu naalu putpam saattiye sutti vandu munumunu endu sollum mandaram edada. Nattakallum pesumo naadan ullirukai. Sutta satti sattuvam karisuvai ariyumo. My dear brother, my dear sister, it is not only a graven image. The Lord says, you need not bow down before anybody, any image, seeking its favor. Seeking its favor. Neither man nor image. For He is the Lord. He is the Lord. So if the Lord is to bless us, the formula is seek the Lord. Worship the Lord. There's no other graven image in your life. There is no other alternative for you to seek its favor, to bless you, to meet all your needs, to pray unto. We don't have anybody. We don't have anything that could bless us. God is here to bless us. Number two, I got a lot of verses to go through. I'll go a little fast. Number two, Sabbath should be sanctified. I was thinking about it yesterday. It's not only in Christianity. All these things transcends religion. In every religion we see people, they keep these things. And every religion we see people, those who keep these things only because of tradition. In every religion we see people who keep these things seriously. It is a spiritual constitution in every man. You take Hindus. Though they do pujas in their house every day, weekly once, devout Hindus, they go to temple. Weekly once, devout Muslims, they go to the mosque. Devout Jews, they go to their synagogues. Christians, transcending all denominations, they go to the church. It is God constituted. One day in 7 days for the Lord. It is to show whether we revere God or not. If you go to Exodus chapter 31 from verse 12, the Lord spoke unto Moses saying, speak thou also unto the children of Israel saying, verily my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. Christianity is not a religion, it's a way of life. It is how we should live. Here the Lord says it's a sign between me and you, how you keep, how you revere the Sabbath. The Lord doesn't say 6 days is the Sabbath for you, only one day you can do your civil work. The Lord says 6 days you do your work, one day you keep my Sabbath. It's a sign between me and you throughout your generations. You shall keep the Sabbath, therefore, because of that you keep the Sabbath. It is holy unto you. It is something that you set apart from all the other days. Everyone that defileth it shall surely be put to death. For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among the people. Jesus never taught that you should not keep the Sabbath. Instead, Jesus taught strongly how you should keep the Sabbath. Jesus never said that you need not keep the Sabbath. Nobody accused him that Jesus was never keeping the Sabbath. Jesus was showing to the people how a Sabbath should be kept. 6 days may work be done. Do all your work 6 days. But in the seventh, literally speaking, any day of the 7 days, at a city set apart by your community. But in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest. Rest is not relaxing. The literal meaning of rest is change of work. The literal philosophic meaning of rest is change of work. Why is the Sabbath called rest? All the 6 days you are spending time for your daily chores. Washing vessels, washing clothes, baking good dishes for the children, going to office, going to school, studying your lessons. What is the rest? On one day, change of work. Change of work. If all 6 days you are lying down, rest is walking. Rest is not lying down. So this one day, have a change of occupation. This one day spent for your spiritual activities. It is holy. It is holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death. Wherefore, the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generation, for a perpetual covenant. When the Lord has said a perpetual covenant, we cannot imagine Jesus came to change the covenant. Keeping the Sabbath is the covenant relationship with God. Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. Sabbath is not made for God, Sabbath is made for men. Sabbath is made for men, it's a perpetual covenant. Jesus never changed the perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and the earth. And of the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And this rest refreshes you for the next 7 days. When the Lord rested, was it God sleeping? On the seventh day, what's God slumbering? And what did he do on the eighth day? Can anybody tell me? God worked for 7 days, 6 days, on the seventh, and what did he do on the eighth day? He finished all his creations in 6 days. Seventh day he rested. And what was he doing on the eighth day? So 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, again he created something. And 14th day he started resting. It makes no sense. From the 7th day, his plan of eternity began. 6 days he created. From the 7th day he blesses. He is there to bless us. He keeps his eyes on us. So this, from the day of creation, all these 6,000 years, he is working. That is his rest. To bless us, to keep us, to protect us, to fight our battles, to make our name great. He is still working on us. This rest is working on us to make us what he wants us to be. So the formula for a blessing, number one, never seek anybody for their favor. Don't say, Ugradhan nambi irukkiren. That's a curse. Tell the Lord, Ummadhan nambi irukkiren andavare. We don't have any image. Any man, any woman, any beast, which we can depend for our blessings. Number two, set apart the day of Sabbath for the Lord, for the church, in the church in India. Now it is Sunday. Any day is the seventh day, depends upon which day is the first day. In most of the corporate calendars, you see Sunday as the seventh day. Monday will be the first day. And there is a move to declare Tuesday as a public holiday in India. Some Christians are worried about it. I tell you, there's nothing to worry about it. Then Monday would be the seventh day and Tuesday would be the first day of the week. That's all. Set apart the first day of the week to have your spiritual activities. Number three, it's very, very important to have reverence of the place of worship. I heard some people misunderstanding and misquoting John 4:21. That Jesus told that woman, we can pray to God anywhere. Or anywhere is a worship place. In Tamil translation, there's a suggestion for that. But even it's only a suggestion. Neither in the original, nor in any other English translation, it is mentioned. I read how it is in our King James Version. Jesus saith unto that Samaritan woman, women, believe me, the hour cometh, when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. He didn't say you can worship anywhere. Engum avare tholudhu kollum kaalam var, that we don't see it in the original, we don't see it in English. I referred many other translations. I just read contemporary English version to you. Jesus said to her, believe me, the time is coming when you won't worship the Father either on this mountain or in Jerusalem. My dear brother, my dear sister, nevertheless, not in the mountain of Samaria, not in Jerusalem. We can worship him in Waitara. We can worship him in America. We can worship him in Australia. We can worship him in Kuala Lumpur. Anywhere we worship him. But wherever we gather to worship, to feel the presence of God in that place, we must know how to revere that place. And if you shall despise my statutes, or
if your soul abhor my judgments,
so or in your soul, they're all too much. How can I do all these things? In your psyche, if you've got a resentment at God's judgments,
so that you will not do all my commandments,
you may do a part of his commandments, not all his commandments,
but that ye break my covenant.
And you made a covenant with the Lord. You gave a promise to the Lord, I will do this. I'll pray every day, 1 hour. You made a promise to God, I will do this. And you are not very serious about breaking your covenant with the Lord. You don't know that you are not very serious. You are given that promise to an almighty God. If you break my covenant, yes,
I also will do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption.
A type of a fear. A fear concerning work, a fear concerning the future, a fear concerning the studies. In the subconscious mind, a fear tormenting us. Consumption a wasting disease, something that robs our money, something that robs our health, something that robs our joy, consumption, it consumes, it drains our energy. And yes,
consumption and the burning ague.
Burning ague means a type of a heavy fever.
That shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart, and ye shall sow
it. It gives us sorrow of heart, sadness, not rejoicing, sorrowful. All these things are symptom of curse, yes?
And ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it.
You do a lot of work and you won't get the benefit of it. I know, brother. Monthly he was paying 60,000 rupees as interest. 60,000 rupees as interest. And for 2,000 and 5,000, he would be coming to me. I told him, Anna, why you earn 60,000 rupees and give to interest and going somewhere for 2,000, 5,000? You close your business, settle all your dues, go somewhere, work and earn 5,000 rupees, that would be better. He earns, he slogs for 60,000 rupees. Somebody else is eating that 60,000 rupees. It is a curse. You sow, but you don't eat. Somebody eats it. It is a curse. Verse 17.
And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you. And
they that hate you will have an upper hand. They that hate you will have an upper hand. That's a curse. And you shall flee when none pursues you. Even a phone call comes, you'll be scared. In one place it says, you'll be scared even to the breaking of a dry leaf. Even when you hear the noise of a breaking of a dry leaf, you'll be scared. No one pursues you, but you run. You're scared. The Bible says it's a curse. Verse 18.
And if ye will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins.
Here at least in four places the Lord says, if you don't hearken unto me, I'll explain what is this later, I will punish you seven times more for your sins. So this is the first list. Second list from verse 19. Yes.
And I will break the pride of your power. And
you thought, oh, I'm very powerful. I got a big car. I got a big house. Everything else to take baptism. Was I not postponing it? I said, yes, I remember. The week after week he told me about baptism, I was postponing it. Is not that true? Yes, yes, brother. You know why? I had only one lungi. I was coming to the church with that lungi. When we got saved, my wife had only one sari. She will wash that sari. And half the sari, he will put it around her waist and wait till the half of the sari is dried. Then she'll change the other half and wait for the first half to get dried. If we could take baptism, we didn't have a change of clothes. The Lord has blessed us. The Lord has blessed us. That's why we called you to pray for that almirah when we bought the first almirah to keep our clothes. We called you to pray again when we bought the second almirah. These are the clothes, just only 1 year old. This year only we bought. Pastor, give to somebody. Our almera is overflowing. There was a time when you have to throw away the old to take the new. But now you have to go to the street. You have to pay some money. He wastes the food. He wastes the food and gives to you. Is it not a curse? Verse 27.
And if ye will not for all this hearken unto me, but walk contrary unto me, then I will walk contrary unto you also in fury.
In fury. The ferocity of curses. 49 times 49. If you don't repent, if you can't change your ways, ferocity of curses. Verse 29.
And ye shall eat the flesh of your sons, and the flesh of your daughters shall ye eat.
And what a horrible thing. You won't have mercy for your wife. You won't have mercy for your children. You can't love your children anymore. You can't love your family anymore. The real joy is not in the family. Brother cannot love the sister. Sister cannot love the brother. Brother tries to rob something that belongs to the sister. Sister tries to rob something that belongs to the brother. Wife has become selfish. Husband has become selfish. Parents have become selfish. Children have become selfish. There's no real love in the family. 49 times 49. 49 times 49. It's a curse. You don't have money to pay the fees of your children. You don't have money to buy some snacks for your children. You don't have money to buy bread for your children. That wicked man finds money for his drinks. He doesn't have money to buy food. He doesn't have money to buy clothes for his people. He has got money for his peg. It's a curse. He is not bothered anymore about his family. He doesn't know whether his wife ate or not. If somebody can give him a morsel of bread, he is enough for him. His heart has become stony. At what point of time the iniquities of their fathers shall they pine away with them? Because of their fathers, because of the mothers, the children also pine away. Children suffer because of their parents. Why should this happen? Number one, formula for blessing. No graven image. Other than God, there's nobody for you. Sanctified Sabbath. Reverence for sanctuary. Obeying God's commandments. Fullness of blessing. Spiritually, emotionally, mentally, financially, socially. In every area God blesses. From verse 14 to 38, the ferocity of disobedience. Seven times more, 49 times 49. I'm going to tell you something very interesting. Five easy steps to recover today. If this has been a message to somebody, the Lord has brought you over here to listen to this. 5 easy steps for your blessing. Why should you pine away? Verse 40.
And if they shall confess their iniquity.
Number 1. Confess your iniquity. Tell the Lord where you went wrong. Especially on the 4 fundamental principles for your blessing. Did you depend on any other being or any other image or any other thing, any other material, any other riches that could help you? In one place, Job says, if I put my trust on gold, I am contrary to God. Did you trust that your gold will help you? Did you trust? At any time in your heart you thought that this gold will help me? Any time you thought this property will help me? That's the image. That was your God. That was your God. You thought your pride, your strength will help you. Your intelligence will help you. So many idols. There's no other idol, there's no other God than God who created you. Your gold cannot be your God. Your gold cannot help you. Your share certificates cannot help you. The inheritance of your the things you inherited from your parents cannot help you. Our God is a jealous God. Confess your iniquity. Lord, I depended on this man. I told that man, sir, ungaladha mala pole nambi iruken. Your fall started there. You told that officer, sir, kai vittradinga sir. Your fall started there. I am your God. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. You tell that man, sir, kai vittradinga sir. The Lord made it possible for him to forsake you. Confess your iniquity. It's not a very grievous sin. You are not a murderer. You are not an adulterer. It was an iniquity that has brought this misfortune in your life. Have you ever transgressed Sabbath? Have you shown disrespect to God's worship place? Maybe in your house or maybe a place where you gather. Just standing out. Not very serious. Return. He will receive you. Number 5. Very carefully I tell you. It is not a license for us to continue in our sin. More sin, more punishment. But very lovingly I tell you one thing. Very lovingly I tell you one thing. He will not change. His compassion will not change. His covenant that he has made with you will not change. However you run away from the Lord, however you break his commandments, however you quarrel his covenant, however you turn your back to him, however you go after your graven image, like the wife of Hosea, you go after whoredom. You go after whoredom. Brother, sister, his love towards you is great. His faithfulness to you is great. He will not change. His covenant will not change. His promise will not change. His oath will not change. What he told Abraham, what he told Isaac, what he told Jacob, what he told Moses, what he told David, he will not change his covenant, brother. What he promised in you in Jesus, he will never take it away from you. He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. He will wait for you to come. When that boy returned home, the father ran forward, hugged him, embraced him, took him into his house. None of his wickedness changed the heart of the father. I tell you, you can never be too wicked to change the heart of your God. You can never be too wicked. You cannot be so wicked that God has changed. My dear brother, my dear sister, if God has made a covenant with you, patiently he is waiting for you to come back to him. He will embrace you. The latter glory will be greater than the former glory. The elder son will stand and astonished. Oh, you didn't do all these things for me. My dear brother, my dear sister, when you come back to the Lord, it is the Lord's word to you. You will not remember your former days. You will not remember how much you suffered. What was the agony you are going through? Your land will begin to, your house will begin to enjoy God's new blessings, blessings abundantly. Go home and read chapter 26, Leviticus again. It's a very powerful chapter. It's a very powerful chapter. In the first three verses, you see the formula for your blessings. From verse 4 to 13, you read about the fullness of blessings. From 14 to 38, the dreadful ferocity of disobedience. Ferocity of disobedience. Verses 41 and 42, five easy steps to recover. Confess your iniquities. Confess the iniquities of your forefathers. Confess the ways you walked contrary to the Lord. Confess it. Confess it. Have a circumcised heart. A covenant relationship with God. Reconcile to Him. Tell the Lord that you accept the punishment He has given you. He has punished you justly. That's what the malefactor on the cross said. We suffer justly. Nama nyayapadi thandikapattom. God told you, you'll be with me in paradise today. Tell the Lord, I suffer justly. Five principles. God loves to bless you. Your sufferings are only wake-up call to wake you up, not to destroy you. Whether you want to be blessed or you want to have curses is not in anybody's hand. It is in your hand. If you obey blessings, if you disobey, despise God's ways, curses. Whatever your curses situation may be, lesson number four, if you repent and return, He will receive you wholeheartedly. Number five, a great promise. Whatever our life may be, He will not change. He will not break His covenant. He will not break His promise. He will not break His oath. He loves us. This is the day of your blessing. He will bless you. He will make you grow abundantly. Blessed in the land, blessed without the land. Your bonds will be blessed. The works of your hand will be blessed. Your spiritual life will be blessed. Your life will be a sanctuary unto the Lord. You will have peace. And no wild beast will come into your family life. No wild beast will eat your children. No poverty. No consuming sickness. Your barns will be full to receive new blessings, new harvest. You have to give away the old remaining things. God will walk among you. God will be pleased with you. God will bless you and make your life a blessing. I pray for you. If you know the Lord, it's the Lord's message for you, for your blessings. Just put your right hand on your chest. Look unto the Lord. I remember you. I'll be one with you in prayer. Spirit of the loving God. Not I, Lord, but you see the dear peoples, those who are looking unto you today. The Lord wants me to tell you, brother, tell you, sister, this day is a turning point in your life. This day is a turning point in your life. This 27th of April you shall not forget. Your bitterness will become sweet. Your sorrow will be turned into rejoicing. He'll wipe away all your tears, and there will be joy in your life. Instead of the garment of sighing, he put on the garment of gladness. He quickens your spirit. You'll go back home not as you came. This is the Lord's word to you. Thank you, Father. Bless your people. Send them back home with the heavenly benedictions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Why should we pine away? God wants to bless you. God wants to bless your family.